turn to the issue of defining value, in particular, defining value of cancer care and, of course, value to whom. And to get us started on that, I'm very pleased to introduce Alan Balch. Alan is the Chief Executive Officer of the Patient Advocate Foundation as well as the National Patient Advocate Foundation. He's been involved in the executive leaderships of a number of organizations that kind of lead into his present position. Until 2013, he was the Vice President of the Preventive Health Partnership. He had been Executive Director of the Friends of Cancer Research. He's led a variety of federal advocacy efforts, so he's got a very good sense of the patient side of things, the clinical side of things, public health, as well as the policy side of things, and so he's perfectly positioned to do this. He got his PhD in environmental studies from the University of California, Santa Cruz, which explains his California background, a master's in environmental science, and bachelor's as well as biology, so he kind of comes from the sciences side of things. But most important today, he's going to point out to us why now we care so much about defining value in this environment, and in particular from the standpoint of the patient. So, Alan, welcome, sir.
So I'm going to do my best to stay within the allotted time. I know we're running a little behind. Thank you for the opportunity to speak and provide the perspective on behalf of patients and patient advocacy groups on the idea of value. Let's see if I'm smart enough to work this thing. All right. There we go. The green button goes forward. Very straightforward. So first, a little grounding. Patient Advocate Foundation is an organization that provides direct patient support along the lines of the types of things that Bonnie and Terry were describing. We help patients find financial resources or provide direct financial resources to patients, as well as help them navigate their insurance benefits, help them get enrolled in different products, different safety net programs. We do that for about 100,000 patients a year. And we provide support to a lot of different types of patients, over 300 different disease areas, but primarily in oncology since the need is so acute. So that's kind of the background from which these thoughts are coming from. So I will say that, you know, the times are changing. There is a lot of change on the horizon. So the window of change, as they say, in the policy world is open. So the time is now. I'm not going to go through all these different bullet points. You could probably make a full circle, but I just gave you a half a circle today. But just to highlight some of them, there's big changes that have been occurring, continue to occur with regard to data, electronic health records, personal technology, instant access to data through wearable technology, consolidation, tremendous consolidation out there in the hospital market, in the pharmaceutical industry, as well as insurers, emergence of different channel strategies around specialty pharmacy, practice-based PBMs, as well as quality, lots of interesting things happening around quality sets and patient-reported outcomes. The science is dramatically changing, particularly in oncology with precision medicine, a very sophisticated crowd. I'm assuming everybody has a pretty good understanding of what precision medicine is and the promise that it brings. And reimbursement, there are dramatic changes happening in the reimbursement environment. All these things and the rapid pace of change both creates an opportunity for defining and redefining the healthcare system to help address many of the challenges and bring Terry back from the cliff, hopefully, to create a better system for patients and providers. So I'm going to just focus on four key areas that I think are really the key, and there, you could debate this or not, but what I think are four key areas around precision medicine, patient engagement, alternative payment models or payment reform, as well as quality measurement. These are four very important issues that are conflating, if you will, to create an opportunity for change. But how are all these things going to fit together in this era of shifting from volume to value, particularly in oncology? So there's a great article from Porter in New England Journal of Medicine from 2010 that is often referred to. I refer to it a lot. It was, I think, a watershed opportunity to define value. I'm going to come back to this at the end, but I think the two most important points that Porter made was that achieving high value for patients must become the overarching goal of the healthcare delivery system, and that the creation of value for patients should determine the rewards for all the other actors in the systems. And the only way to accurately measure value is to track patient outcomes and costs longitudinally. So the key questions are, and I'll try to answer some of these, but we have a panel discussion, and I certainly don't have the answers to all these questions. But it seems there's general agreement around the idea that value is some measurement of costs over benefits. particularly in the context of patients, and that there's general agreement that the goal should be to create better value for patients. But how do we track and measure outcomes and benefits longitudinally and costs, and how should the focus be? Should the focus be on providing value to patients at a population level or at an individual level? And some of the audience questions already stole my answer to that question. And do we achieve better value for cancer patients by standardizing their care or personalizing their care? So I'm going to skip the population level because I think it is important. I think it has important repercussions. It's an important level at which to think about cancer care and about healthcare in general. There's a lot of opportunities. You know, it's important to consider what's the societal value being derived from the allocation of healthcare resources. So I don't want to dismiss that. It is important. But I do want to focus on the idea of standardization because I think population level thinking often goes hand in hand, not always, but often goes hand in hand with the idea of standardization. Also an important idea and also a way to reduce variability, reduce errors, reduce costs. It can be an important way to try to provide better value, to provide better health outcomes as well as reduce costs, but I think it makes more sense in certain circumstances. So you have to use standardization thoughtfully and surgically, if you will. Surgery is one of those areas where standardization may make a lot of sense, knee and hip replacement, labor, care and delivery, those types of areas. I think one important thing to keep in mind about standardization is if you have to keep, who's in the denominator? And if you're standardizing care and coming up with treatment options based on the average patient, that person before you may not represent the data on which that average patient protocol was developed, particularly if you're African American or Hispanic Latino, or there's some characteristic about your disease that's unique or about you as an individual that's unique that makes you different, very different from the average. So I'm going to focus on this level, the individual level. And I think that's really where you're thinking about benefits and costs and the healthcare delivery at the level of the individual and their family. A lot of the types of services and conversations that happened in the previous panel were all about how do you try to find and treat patients at that individual level and their caregivers, because that's the level at which the patients are experiencing the healthcare system. So at the clinical level, the focus would be on determining the best treatment options based on the unique characteristics of the individual and also their own value preferences. It's more of a bottom-up approach. I'll come back to that idea. This is not a new idea. The original, you know, when the four main primary care organizations came together in 2007 to define common principles for the personal medical home, this was in their fact sheet. The traditional doctor, so this is the primary concept of the medical home, is the traditional doctor's office is transformed to the central point for Americans to organize and coordinate their health care based on their needs and priorities. At its core is an ongoing partnership. So this idea of not just patient engagement, but partnership has been around for a long time and codified here in this fact sheet from these organizations, where the consumer decides who is on his or her team and the primary care physician makes sure they are working together to meet all the patient's needs in an integrated, whole person fashion. So I think that framework still provides a nice platform to think about the future of healthcare, particularly in oncology. So personalization, I think, as opposed to standardization, ties very nicely in with this idea of thinking at the individual level. So it's not always true, but it is generally true that if you want to personalize and you want to individualize, you're talking about customization and meeting the patient and the individual where they are. Beautifully articulated by the woman in the back who talked about the choose your own adventure. I thought I was the only one that used that choose your own adventure reference, so I'm glad to see that I'm not the only one who remembers those books, and I'm sure they're still out there. It does not, let me just be clear though, it does not mean an all-access pass to everything and anything. I often hear that, well, you got to decide somewhere, you can't just let people have everything. Well, that's true. But as the clinical guidelines that NCCN has produced every year has shown us, that you can provide a range of options based on the evidence to patients and let shared decision making and clinical judgment help you delineate and decide between those options. So a customized approach to certain treatment regimens may provide better outcomes actually at a better cost. So the assumption often is that standardized care actually is a more cost-effective strategy. It is certainly a better way to predict what your costs are going to be and control costs, but I would argue that particularly in the right medical and clinical context, that precision medicine and personalized medicine actually saves money as well, because you're getting the right medication to the right patient at the right time and avoiding other costs associated with medications that may not be appropriate, although they may be within the standard of care or may make sense for 80% statistically of that patient who has that disease. It may not be the right choice for that particular patient. So what is the right approach for oncology? And this is my one chance in these slides to go back to my biology roots. I'm so excited. So if you think back to what is cancer, what is it fundamentally a disease? It's a disease of cellular mutation. And what is mutation but a genetic variation? It is the essence of evolutionary biology. So the very nature of cancer as a disease, as a genetic variation, makes it more conducive inherently to customization and personalization. There certainly are opportunities to standardize care in oncology, so I don't want to suggest there's no way to standardize oncology care. You have lots of procedures that have a start and end point, surgery, radiology, where you can standardize care, but generally speaking, especially when it comes to treatment selection, I would argue that it needs to be the force, the organizing force for cancer care really needs to be customization and personalization. So what does that mean? If you qualify in oncology, if quality in oncology becomes defined as a rigid standardization of treatment protocols, then what you're going to get is treatment options that are limited and average. And I don't bring this up lightly. There's actually, in my mind, this might be too dramatic, but a bit of a battle waging over what is the future of oncology going to be. There's windows open, as I mentioned, around alternative payment models and pathways and all these other tools that are being brought to the market around redefining and retooling the healthcare environment, but there is a tension between whether it's going to be standardized or whether it's going to be personalized, and precision medicine is sort of the clinical and medical backdrop against which all this is playing out. So I just want to make that point that the time is now. There is an urgent need to really push forward on this idea of how do we truly individualize and personalize oncology care in particular, and I think that can translate into other care areas as well. So really what we need is a system that supports shared decision-making, a shared decision-making model that leads to personalized care that is evidence-driven and not standardized care based on a subset of the guidelines. So the stars are aligned. I think you've got several factors that are coming together at once that really, I think, are conducive to this personalized approach to healthcare. Precision medicine, I already mentioned. There's a lot of cost shifting to patients. It's not like the old days when patients only had a small out-of-pocket cost. This idea of skin in the game has put patients in a position where they're bearing a lot of the costs now to tens of thousands of dollars, if not more, for their own health care. So now they have not only a moral right, but a financial right to be more active participants in their health care decision because they are paying a lot out of their own pocket. So we should start thinking of them as consumers and start thinking of this more and more as a consumer-driven market and starting to organize around that basic concept. Shared decision-making, I'll go into detail about that, this whole concept of patient centricity. I'll talk a little bit about that as well. I do think that, sort of in a all-American fashion, that we're more attuned in this country and more used to being engaged consumers in the U.S. marketplace. So I think, in particular, given the sort of the political economy of our own country, the personalized approach and the individualized approach, I think, works better with our own culture. So imagine the American flag and the Star-Spangled Banner waving in the background. So what are some of the tools of personalization? This goes, I think, to your last question to the panel, Cliff, was I think patient engagement is a key tool. Care planning and shared decision making. When I say care planning, I'm referring to navigation, care coordination, a whole panoply of things that go with the idea of care planning. Patient-reported outcomes, clinical judgment, and pathways. And I put a question mark there, and I'll come back to that in a second. So patient engagement, I think we heard very eloquently what that really means. And I think patients need to be engaged like never before. They need to be their own advocates. A lot of my colleagues don't talk just about patient engagement, but actually patient partnership, which goes back to that original personalized medical home definition from 2007. Individual choices must be made in a context of voluntary cooperation and coordination. Patients do not want, and this goes to your point, Terry, about having a navigator forced on you, they don't want non-voluntary choices or forced behavioral choices. They want to have options, the choose your own adventure analogy. Shared decision making is, we heard very eloquently how complicated and confusing the system has become for patients to navigate. Shared decision making is part of that process of helping patients navigate that and make decisions that really reflect their individual preferences and their families and their caregivers. And at the heart of this, as Terry mentioned as well, is the relationship and trust between patients and their providers. You cannot, anything and everything we can do to build and maintain that trust and that relationship between the patient and their care team is paramount. And patients have the right to be involved. So it's not just about clinical decision making when we talk about shared decision making. It's about all the decisions out there in the environment, the macro environment, that are affecting patients and their access and ability to afford care. So decisions being made by provider institutions, by insurance companies, by government. I apologize for sounding like, you know, we're coming, but we are. And we feel like we have a right to be at any table where a decision is being made that is going to affect patients and their access and affordability care. Patients and patient organizations that represent them need to be involved at the beginning of those discussions to make sure that the outcome of those are going to be such that they will benefit patients and lead to better value for patients. So this also is about clinical judgment. And I had to boil this down to two important concepts to keep in mind. It's shared decision making and clinical judgment. And there is a battle waging out there over those two concepts and what they're going to look like and how they're going to be operated in the future. Physicians must have the freedom to be able to choose to consider a range of treatment options for their patients based on guidelines and carefully weigh the risks, benefits, and costs associated with the treatment options with the patient without regard to reimbursement or incentive attached to a particular course of therapy, at least initially. Another point I believe that Terry made was that patients aren't ready to sit there, and most aren't ready to digest that whole cost conversation, that initial treatment option. You asked the question, Cliff, when's the right time to have that conversation? For some patients, they want to have it up front. This gets to the idea of meeting the patients where they are and what they want to know at that decision-making point. But I think for most patients, you want to give them the options first, you know, and talk them through what are the benefits, you know, that are important to them and what are the risks that are important to them with regard to those treatment options, and then figure out which ones make the most sense, and then start to talk about costs and incentives, et cetera. So it's not that those aren't important things to consider. I think generally speaking, those should be the second part of the conversation. The first conversation should really be about what's the most appropriate treatment option based on your unique characteristics and your value framework and what you're trying to achieve with your care. And this really puts an emphasis on personalized medicine over cookbook medicine, particularly from oncology. Whatever we can do, and we can talk on the panel about what some of those options might be, but you know, we want to encourage and empower providers to engage their patients in a robust decision-making process. And I use the provider term generally because I don't know that it's necessarily the physician or the doctor. To the conversation about different roles and different mid-level roles that mid-level providers and others can play, I think there are opportunities to think about who's the appropriate person to provide that shared decision-making support, and it has to be reimbursed. It has to be incentivized. It has to be measured, and it has to be paid for until we figure out a different system that doesn't require that level of hand-holding that the current system does, and I don't know that we'll be able to recreate it completely to eliminate the need for that level of hand-holding. I can't get through a talk without talking about pathways. I could do a whole talk just about pathways, but in the interest of time, I'll just very briefly say that pathways, I put a question mark by it because I think it can be an incredible tool for personalizing care and bringing the evidence base that's surrounding the unique characteristics of the individual to the hand, to the fingertips of that provider at that decision-making time. It can also be a tool used to standardize care and treat patients to the average. And I think we need to be very careful about who's controlling pathways, who's designing them, and what their intent is. And I think pathways can be a great tool for personalization, but they can also be a tool for over-standardization. I think we need to keep that in mind as we watch the evolution of pathways. So coming back to the idea of value, and just to wrap up here in a few slides, the notion of value, you know, if we agree that it's about the patient, and that it's about measuring outcomes and benefits and cost to patients longitudinally, then how are you going to define how those outcomes are defined must be based on the notion of patient-centered care. So how do the Institute of Medicine define patient-centered care? Providing care that is respectful of and responsive to individual patient preferences, needs, and values, and ensuring that patient values guide all clinical decisions. So there are challenges to this, and this leads us into our panel discussion. When you're talking about value and how to measure it, for oncology in particular, in my environmental background, we talked a lot about cost effectiveness for things like dams, other things where you try to figure out what's the long-term benefit, what's the cost, how do you make a net present value decision based on a decision you have to make today. Oncology is just like one of those examples that are really difficult to apply a long-term cost effectiveness model to, because oncology has high upfront costs that are easy to quantify in dollars. But the benefits of treatment can either be very short-term and difficult to quantify, but still things that matter a lot to patients. Don't, you know, 3 months or 2 months to a patient could mean an enormous amount, even though it doesn't show up high on some of the clinical value scores. Or in the case of long-term survival, the benefits can accrue over long periods of time and can be very difficult to quantify, particularly in dollars. And patients often value very different things than what providers and payers value. And I'm not saying that, you know, we should eschew that those should be shunned. Those are important, but I think we need to place a priority and a premium on patient individual patient preferences and values and trying to figure out what that is. There's a great article recently in the New England Journal of Medicine by Newman that talked about how value is it's elusive. There's really no consensus around what dimension should be taken into account. He did suggest along the lines of what I'm talking about that we need to think about adverse events and ancillary benefits that matter to patients alongside cost-effectiveness ratio, and that if we're developing online tools and other things for stakeholders to look at drug costs, for example, we need to consider a variety of characteristics and quality of life issues and patient-reported outcomes associated with that, as well as just the cost and the clinical benefits. When we talk about clinical care that matters to patients, we spent 3 years developing a tool called the Consumer-Based Cancer Care Value Index, and we actually spent a lot of time trying to identify what are the important things that patients value in terms of their clinical care experience. I'm not going to go into details around the results, just to say that in our field tests, in our pilot tests, with several thousand patients in the sample size, these are the things that rise to the top in terms of what matters to patients in terms of their clinical care experience. Feeling like your doctors are up to date on your type of cancer and treatments. Feeling like your doctors knew what they were doing in treating your cancer. Feeling that doctors were completely honest and direct with you, and going down to the bottom, getting the best medical care available regardless of how serious your cancer was, being informed about different options for treating your cancer. Cost is an important factor to take into consideration when you're thinking about value, and there's been a lot of discussion about one dimension of cost, which is drug costs. I'm here to tell you on behalf of the low-income patients that we serve every year, our average patient income is about $23,000 a year household income. These are the things that they're calling and asking for help with when it comes to cost. It's copay assistance, not for drugs, but for hospital visits and doctor's visits. They are asking for assistance with pharmaceutical products. They're also asking for assistance with everyday cost of living, transportation expenses, utilities, rent. So this is the world of cost and cost hardships from the patient perspective, particularly the low-income perspective. When we go back and ask them, what's actually driving your financial hardship? What are the elements of that financial cost journey that you're on that are actually causing you financial distress? Again, office visits to physicians and hospitals come up as at 56%, laboratory services, prescriptions, visits to other medical providers, radiology services, and surgery. So when we talk about costs, we have to really think about the total cost of care, as others had already mentioned. I'm going to skip this. This was some data from one of our surveys that just showed how, you probably can't see it anyway, but 50% of patients that we surveyed in our population actually were employed at the time of their cancer, before their cancer diagnosis. That drops to 30% employment either during or after their cancer diagnosis. Most of those patients end up retiring or going on disability. So that's just a little nugget of thinking about other types of benefits and costs outside of the things we typically think about clinically speaking. So we have to think about benefits in a totally different way. You have to think about quality measures that must reflect outcomes that matter to patients, measures needed to assess care planning and shared decision making. We have to reward providers in the healthcare system for delivering care and identifying treatment plans that align with their patients' values and individual preferences. Reward them for helping that patient choose their own adventure, so to speak. We need a much greater emphasis on identifying outcomes that truly matter to patients and developing systems that allow robust reporting of those patient-reported outcomes. So I come back to Porter's original definition of value. Again, just stressing that achieving high value for patients must become the overarching goal of healthcare delivery, and value needs to be defined around the customer. The creation of value for patients should determine the rewards for all the actors in the system. And my closing thoughts are the process as a whole, you know, speaking about being at the edge of the cliff, I do think we have an opportunity to really, and the opportunity is right upon us now with what CMS is doing with shifting to alternative payment models with their goals of 2016 and 2018. There's an incredible window that is going to be open for a short period of time to really rethink and redesign as much as we possibly can the current healthcare system along these lines of patient centricity. And what we need is a process so that treatment protocols are optimized and personalized for each patient according to that patient's personal preferences and goals, as well as the provider's clinical judgment. There are multiple stakeholders working to define value and quality, and that's great. I'm not saying they shouldn't do it, but you have a lot of payers, doctors, scientists in this space. That's wonderful. But patient groups and patients themselves need to fight for the importance of enabling value to be expressed at the individual patient level. Ultimately, the rallying cry should be patient centricity rather than value, because an emphasis on the former is the way to get us to the latter. So with that, I'll close. Sorry, I went a few minutes over.
And if our panelists could come up to the front. Al, if you would just take that chair closest to where you were standing, that would be great. And if we could have Alan and then Bob and Terry, Shelley, Dan, Dana, in that order. All right, welcome, everyone. Thank you very much. Great setup, Alan. That's good. We've already met Alan and Bob, and we've met Terry. In a moment, we're going to meet three additional panelists. And let's set it up like this. With regard to value, this is probably the hottest time to be considering the issue of value. And I'm going to ask the panelists in a few minutes why it's such an important time to look at value. And one of the ways of sort of demonstrating the need to capture value is about five concurrent initiatives for assessing value, more or less the way Alan laid out. And I'll tell you what they are. They did start with a Porter framework, 2009-ish, which is kind of a starting point. But right now, in sort of the hubbub of policy discussions within the healthcare environment, there are about five of these value frameworks floating around out there. We're going to have three of them represented on this panel, and a fourth will be represented in a subsequent panel. They are the American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association have a value framework. The ASCO has a value framework. The ICER, which is the Institute for Clinical and Economic Review, has a value framework. Memorial Sloan Kettering has something it calls Abacus, which is a type of value framework. And the National Comprehensive Cancer Network has changed what it does insofar as qualifying its guidelines with a value framework-like concept. And so why these things arose are things like, as Memorial Sloan Kettering has been pointing out for years, that when a newly approved cancer drug hits the market, the monthly cost of this can be typically $10,000 or more a month. So that's been catching some attention. A lot of you may have heard about the expensive hepatitis C drugs that started out as $1,000 a pill. And by the way, they cure a lot of people. But at $1,000 a pill for 12 weeks, that started to hit some budgets, and so some people are concerned about value there. And more recently, and I hope that Dan will talk about this as well, there's something called the PCSK9 inhibitors, which are special new drugs for hyperlipidemia. And so these sort of events have sort of catalyzed this great attention on value in a way that has been building for years, but this year it just really, really did hit. And so with regard to kind of getting folks' perspectives, like I said, you've met Alan, Bob, and Terry. Shelley Fuld, Nasso, tell us who you are and with whom you are, and in a sentence or two, why you care about value.
Okay. I'm Shelley Fuld, Nasso, with the National Coalition for Cancer Survivorship. I'm clutching my water bottle because I'm a little bit voice challenged like Terry today. So hopefully I will be able to speak clearly. I think that we've heard a lot of great things about value. Why we care about this is the cost. I mean, everybody's concerned about cost of care. But I think what we have to do really is make a distinction between value to society and value to patients. Because I think Terry put it so beautifully. You don't, when you are faced with making the decision about your care, you're not thinking, what is the highest value care I can get? You're thinking, how can I save my life? And it's just not, I don't think it's how patients think about it. They value time with their physicians, but if you ask them about a value framework, that's not really how they think about their care. But we as a society need to think about that. So I just think we have to be careful about separating from the societal need to look at some of these on a policy level and the discussion between a doctor and a patient about that patient's care.
Well, echoing Alan's point about there's a population perspective here and an individual patient perspective here as well. Dan Ollendorf, tell people who you are and why you care about value.
Great. Thanks, Cliff. So I'm with the Institute for Clinical and Economic Review. We're a nonprofit organization based in the Boston area. We were really founded on the premise that conversations around how different tests and treatments compare clinically and how they compare economically really were best had in public. And so we are funded by a number of nonprofit foundations. Over the years, we've evaluated procedures, devices, health system interventions, and not surprisingly, more recently, started to look at the comparative effectiveness and comparative value of drugs in a variety of conditions. I think that what we've realized, and by the way, we still maintain this public presence. We have had two regional deliberative bodies, one in New England, one in California. We're just starting up a third in the Midwest now. And so these are independent councils that include clinicians, patient representatives, public representatives, all of whom review evidence that we present to them and then make determinations about what they consider the value of the new interventions to be, clinically and economically. We want to continue to do that, but we're realizing, and the value framework that we've developed hopefully reflects this, that there's kind of an inextricable link. So what Shelley just mentioned around the notion that patients' considerations are around the value to them. What is this particular treatment going to do for me? How will it extend my life? How will it potentially improve my quality of life so I can spend more time with my loved ones? But we feel that considerations of both what we call care value, that includes the cost-effectiveness analysis that Alan mentioned, as well as health system value, the budget impact to the health system, actually has a very direct link. Excuse me, I should probably get water too. thank you. Has a very direct link to what patients will really need to consider, because the cost to the system to try to manage a new intervention end up getting passed down to the patient, and then the patient
We're a full service panel here, Dan.
Thank
Take
you.
Take care of each other.
The patient may then have challenges in terms of continued access to a given medication. So we try to look at value from both the standpoint of the decision that the patient makes with their clinician and their family, as well as the decision that the organizations paying for the treatment have to make.
Point well taken. Just for those of you that may not have been watching this space, little footnote here. The work that ICER is doing, Dan and his colleagues, has caught a lot of public attention and has been referenced by the large pharmacy benefit managers around the country when they have been negotiating with some of the pharma bio companies for what they consider to be, I'll just say, better prices. And their work is cited very, very often in this, particularly in Hep C, the PCSK9 inhibitors as well. So if you've been sort of watching the news on that, they're having, I won't say a pivotal influence, but they're having a substantial influence on the debate and on actual negotiations of these pricing issues.
Oncology is coming up soon.
Yes. Oh, you heard him say oncology is coming up. We are definitely going to hear about that. Okay. Dana, move to you, who you are, with whom you are, and just a tad about the value framework.
Terrific. Welcome to the panel and to the group, and I'm delighted to be here with everybody. My name is Dana Wollins. I'm Senior Director of Health Policy at the American Society of Clinical Oncology. ASCO, better known as, is a group now about 37,000 members. We represent not only the clinical oncologist, MD, but really the whole spectrum of the cancer care team. One of the key pieces that I like to start with when I describe ASCO is really its core mission and its vision. And the mission of ASCO is to really conquer cancer through research, education, and access to high-quality cancer care. The vision statement was recently actually updated, and I was really pleased because it had this value connection for the first time. And it was to really make sure that there is an availability of the highest quality, most affordable care to the most people possible. And that's a really important addition to our vision statement, and I think that it really exemplifies the commitment to value that ASCO's really taken on. We didn't always start it with a value name. In fact, we started looking at it really about cost, and that's been a shift over time to really reflect the changes in how we're looking at the impact that the oncology community can make. The reason we started with cost, it was actually in 2007, the Cost of Care Task Force was established. And the reason we did that was to look at a very kind of obvious but kind of elephant in the room, I would say. And that was that our doctors were coming and oncology nurses were sitting around the table and talking with us at the staff level and saying, you know, we're really concerned because we have patients coming in, and we don't know if they're not telling us about their financial issues. They're not necessarily, we're not comfortable talking about financial issues, and we don't have good systems in place to make sure we're addressing what now, thanks to Dr. Yusuf Zafar and others, have known as financial toxicity. And we really understood that it was the imperative of the oncology community to start thinking about all toxicities to patients, physical, emotional, and unfortunately, financial. The value framework was a shift from looking at cost alone, because it's certainly not in a vacuum, you provide good care, to the fact of value, which is really the name of the game. You can't walk around without value being something that you hear about today. But I think that the framework is really a way to conceptualize how we can start to look at value. When we look at value at ASCO, we look at it with a very admittedly, unfortunately, still incomplete picture of what we know is important to patients. We know that patients, like Alan did a great job talking about, and many data show, really do care about things that we don't have good metrics for, and we don't have good ways to actually show in a concise way and paint a picture for a patient so they have full decision-making power. Our value framework is a way to try to look at clinical benefit, toxicity, and cost as a starting point to try to make those decisions more easy to have and to provide that transparency of information so that we can begin to deal with that piece that we know is financial toxicity as well as clinical and emotional benefits.
Great. That sets up very nicely, Dana. Couple things here. What we're going to want to do in this panel is this. We want to talk, get the folks that are associated with organizations that have value frameworks and have them sort of lay those out to us. And then we're going to be very, very interested in hearing what our patient folks think about those. And I just commend to you Alan's opening comments about population perspective, individual perspective, and so forth. A couple other things to keep in mind in this conversation are this. The 1, 2, 3, 4, the five value frameworks to which I referred earlier all have something to do with benefits, risks, and some sort of economic component. So it's basically benefits, risks, and something about cost or affordability or something that has to do with economics, not always the same thing. By the way, we'll try to go to Q&A 1230, 1240-ish, depending on how the conversation goes. Bob Carlson, NCCN is generally recognized, and we're not saying this because you've helped set up this meeting, but as the market leader in clinical practice guidelines in oncology. And for the longest time, there was no explicit call for anything having to do with economics, although it was discussed on occasion. Not long ago, you came up with something called an evidence block that helps you qualify your guidelines, and there was this particular addition to the evidence block that has to do with something having to do with economics. Can you tell us why you did that and how it's evolving?
Well, first of all, our panels, when they develop the guidelines, are specifically told to ignore cost. So it's all about effectiveness, toxicity, and data quality and consistency. We had a number of stakeholders come to us with various requests, one of which was they wanted more information about why the panels were making specific recommendations. And that was felt especially important because of Alan's observation that our guidelines are very permissive. There are a lot of choices, a lot of options to allow for different clinical circumstances. And people really wanted to understand why there were so many different options and how they really related one to another. And so we put together a system, and this was a system that really has evolved over multiple years. There have been considerations of how to do this. That would allow that disclosure of the panel's rationale. And it looks at, and those, we've identified four dimensions, efficacy of therapy, safety of the therapy, you can interpret that as the inverse of toxicity, the quality and quantity of data supporting the recommendation, and then the consistency of that data, because you can have high quality studies that have opposite conclusions, and then that's not necessarily all that informative. And we started initiating that at the same time that the concerns of financial toxicity became front and center. And the discussion of value, with value defined as cost, dollar cost, as an issue, And so we decided at that point in time to add a metric of affordability to the evidence block to inform providers, patients, and others about affordability. But that affordability column is not used to define or decide whether or not something gets on the guidelines. We developed a graphical system that we think is very intuitive, and once somebody understands how the graphical system is developed, you can scan through 20 of these evidence blocks. You can interpret 20 different options in our guidelines, probably in about 5 seconds, maybe even faster than that. It's a very efficient system. And we actually don't use the evidence block scores, and each of the metrics is scored on a scale of 1 to 5. And we don't use those scores to come up, to plug those determinations into an equation to come up with a specific number. I mean, you know, 42, what does that mean? But rather, we have the evidence blocks with those different dimensions so that patients, as they come to the table, and providers, as they come to the table, can make their own value equation, if you will, or judgment about which of those factors they personally want to weight the most. And then they can start looking at that. And if cost, affordability in our metric, is an issue, then what that really does is it doesn't tell them a dollar cost. This is going to cost you, you know, $75,000. But what it does say is this is a very expensive therapy, and if cost is an important consideration to you, then you need to go to the financial counselors we heard about in the first panel. You need to go to your payer. You need to understand what the financial implications of your therapy are. And we actually think that's a better, that's for our purposes, we think the optimal system. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that, you know, we were talking about value most of the morning about some metric of efficacy versus cost. But in our conversations with patients, especially, what we have found is that what cost is to a patient is not necessarily what a dollar cost. It's what's the trade-off in survival versus voice preservation? What's the trade-off between delay in therapy versus fertility preservation? You know, the 30-year-old woman who comes in with two small children with an advanced breast cancer, she's not going to care about dollar cost. She's probably not going to care about toxicity. All she wants to hear about is efficacy. I want a therapy that's going to cure me. An 85-year-old woman who comes in with an identical breast cancer, she's not concerned about fertility preservation. She's probably not very concerned about efficacy, although she will be to some extent. But she will be very concerned about toxicity. She will also be very concerned about cost. You know, is it going to exhaust her limited resources so that she's not able to pass on any of her savings or resources to her children when she dies? You know, so in both of those perspectives, you know, the young and the old, we think are perfectly valid. And there are, of course, multiple others. We could come up with thousands of other, you know, comparable scenarios where the value systems are both perfectly appropriate but very different. And so we came up with the idea of presenting the information, presenting the data, and then the provider and the patient, hopefully in a efficient shared decision-making model, can actually then come up with what is the appropriate value equation.
Great. So this is information that is not prescriptive. You're presenting the evidence block, and any same evidence block may be interpreted and used differently by patients and providers depending upon the particular situation. And you also made clear that you kind of draw a thick black line between sort of the clinical and data side, which were the efficacy, safety, quality and quantity of data, consistency of data, and affordability is on the other side of that line, correct?
Yes, and affordability is an additional metric that patients can look at, but again, we don't use, I think there are two or three only circumstances in the entire family of NCCN guidelines where a panel has made a specific recommendation based on cost.
Okay.
And that's sort of jury nullification. They're actually told not to look at cost, but there are several situations where the panels felt that the issue was so egregious that they had to make a statement.
Good, thank you. Shelley couldn't wait for the later discussion. She wants to question you right now on this.
Yeah, I'm going to ask a question to you, Bob. So how would then the evidence blocks help if you're evaluating the same drug for those two different patients? How would that help you do that? Because they have such different values in terms of what they want from their care.
So it allows you to weight the different dimensions differently. So for instance, let's use a real world example, HER2 positive hormone receptor negative breast cancer with five nodes involved. So it's a very high risk breast cancer. Trastuzumab adds major incremental benefit to outcome in a survival dimension. The older you are receiving trastuzumab, the more likely you are to experience cardiac toxicity. A woman who is avoid toxicity primarily, she can look at the toxicity scale and she could actually go down the evidence blocks and only look at the second column. And she could see which of those options are scored as having high safety versus lower safety. Those would presumably the ones with lower safety for a person who is primarily wanting to be toxicity adverse, the high safety ones would be the ones that she would focus on. Mm. And then she could secondarily look at efficacy. It is interesting that if you look at the evidence blocks that we've done to date, and we have two on our website, and there are several others that should be posted very, very shortly. Our panels are clearly making their judgments about preferred regimens versus other regimens, almost exclusively focusing on efficacy. Mm-hmm. That's really the partition, with one exception that we've been able to identify so far. Mm-hmm. You very well know that there are many other things that we need to consider besides efficacy.
So a patient could look at, if a patient's facing, let's say, two or three options, there's an evidence block for each option, and the patient can scan, I guess, down the various columns or the dimensions and compare them that way. If toxicity is most important, he or she will scan down those. If efficacy is most important, scan down those.
Yes, and, uh-huh. And again, it's really an effort to get the conversation started.
Right.
It's not an answer. It's rather to help frame the discussion. You know, this agent is less toxic than that agent. And yet the efficacy is higher, even though it's more toxic. So what does that trade-off look like for you?
Yep.
That's really what the conversation is supposed to be.
Got it. Supporting the conversation, the shared decision-making. Dana, also, let's stay in the oncology world. How does the ASCO framework work? And I know it's kind of detailed and so forth. You kind of give us the synopsis.
Sure.
It was 2014 when it came out?
It actually came out this year.
Oh, early this year.
It came out in June, mm-hmm. and we had it open for a public comment period till August.
Okay.
And after we closed it, we got back many, many, it was very good and surprising to mm-hmm. see. We got about over 400 individual responses, people really giving us their input on it. And we're in the process now of taking that input. And as we had said, it was a conceptual first take, really, when we published it. So exactly.
So what are the basics of it?
So I think, you know, one thing I'll just actually start with saying, and Bob Carlson and others who are speaking about the frameworks you've identified, I think the fascinating thing to me is that these frameworks have all come out as they have, as you started with, right? Why has this happened?
Yeah.
And we've started to talk about that a little bit in the beginning and looking at the question that we're all trying to grapple with these issues. And what's really interesting is sometimes they look different, and they are different fundamentally, a lot of these frameworks, but they're actually also very similar in a lot of ways. And I think that's a good thing, because that means that as people are thinking about these issues, the hope is, and I know this is part of what ASCO's goal has been, that we do start to evolve the way we think about providing information in the best way possible and getting the information out there in a way that's digestible and usable. And nobody, I don't believe, has done it perfectly yet, but I think this is the start.
You've got similar dimensions, do you know?
So the way that ASCO's framework works is we, like NCCN, have really fundamentally focused on clinical benefit, and we call it toxicity, but, you know, safety and cost. But what we do is we have a little bit of some differences. So The first thing that we started out to do and looked at was, let's just take cost and put it separate. Let's not put it as part of an equation, because the fact of the matter is, when people care about thinking about the issues and the trade-offs between different choices of options, they may want to look at and should probably be thinking about, if cost wasn't even a factor, what is this going to give me in my survival, in my overall long-term effects of the treatment, and so on. So we take cost and we put it completely independent. We take clinical benefit and toxicity, and we look at them next to each other, almost like you could imagine a scale, okay? Mm-hmm. And the scale, what will it will give you after you look at clinical benefit and toxicity, it will give you something we call a net health benefit. And there are different definitions, I know, and we take a little bit more of a clinical view, that when we talk about a net health benefit, what we're talking about is, it's almost more like a net health gain of benefit. So you take two different treatment regimens. Okay, in our case, it's important to note too, we focused first out of the gate, we've just focused on drugs so far, and I will say that right off the bat, knowing full well that is just the beginning. Sure. But we've taken the two options, let's say, or more of regimens that have been looked at in a trial, and you want to say, okay, well, what one's better? You know, what one's going to be better for me? Well, let's just first start out, and which one has been shown to be better according to the data? And we do that by saying, okay, well, let's look at survival. And if the survival benefit is there, and often, but not always, you have overall survival. If not, well, let's say, okay, then progression-free survival. We'll use metrics that are reportable in the literature. And it's grounded, I should really emphasize, in evidence-based data. So to fuel any framework, we believe it has to be grounded in the highest level of evidence that is available. And that's why actually we'd love to put more factors into the framework. And once we believe and hope that frameworks like this are out, we hope that, that actually trials will start collecting more outcomes that could start actually becoming part of frameworks. Okay. But net health benefit is going to give you a number. And that number is nothing in isolation. But it will tell you, though, how much better clinically it is over its comparator. And so if a net benefit comes out at 16, that's going to be different than 48 or 100, okay?
So you do assign some...
We do assign a numerical value to what we call our net health benefit.
Okay.
And it's to compare how much better is one treatment over another. Now, to do that, we had to start with some kind of a framing weighting system, because you can imagine you've got overall survival here, you've got toxicities. How do you, apples and oranges, right? How do you do that? Well, we can do that by first starting with just a priori. Let's assign a certain amount of weighting to something that allows you to have 5+ years of overall survival median on average. But let's say there's a what we can call a tail of a curve. So there's a longer, there's a period of people that live a lot longer than that average. Mm-hmm. We account for that too, and it actually goes into the weighting system.
Okay.
How about the toxicities? Well, if there's a lot of high-grade toxicities, we want to make sure that we've shown that it should be more of a ding, right? It should, as opposed to a regimen that has a very low number of very serious side effects, that's going to have less of a ding, right? And I say a ding because it's going to change the weighting the other way. Long story short, ultimately you're going to get a number that actually puts it together based on a weighting system.
And then cost is
Is separate, but here's the thing. In any clinical scenario, and this is where we really want to make an emphasis, and I do really want to make sure this is clear, in a one-on-one discussion with a patient, any weighting of a toxicity versus a survival, how is absolutely has to be a patient-centered decision. So what we imagine is that you sit down, you have a ultimately you're going to need some kind of a tool to do this. Like you said, it's kind of long tables in our framework. You would work with a patient to put their personal weighting in. So if they care more, they're a pianist, and they care because they don't want peripheral neuropathy, and a treatment they're considering has a high degree of that, that's going to get a bigger ding for them.
So both ASCO's approach and NCCN's are presenting information that can be used for individualized decision making. You do sort of come up with a number with the benefit risk trade-off.
Correct.
And the cost side.
And we share that. The idea is that that number would be personally driven and weighted by the patient mm-hmm. with his or her physician, and then shown next to their patient-specific cost.
Okay, now just in briefly, because I know it's quite complicated, briefly, the cost dimension comes in exactly how.
Okay. So ultimately, what does a patient care about? They care about what it's going to cost them, right?
It's going to cost them.
And so we know that when you're sitting down and having a discussion with a patient, what they care about and should be hearing is what it's going to cost them. We know fully well that the framework as we've conceptualized it will only show you a portion of cost. We only have as a very surrogate at this time, we're looking again just mm-hmm. at the drugs, we're taking the clinical benefits, the toxicities, and cost. We're going to show the cost out of pocket to the patient, or what we show in our framework, because patient cost is extremely individualized. Okay. We use drug acquisition cost. I think it's the same thing that Bob, you all use, I believe, but you can, nope, you have
different.
To correct me. All right, different, we can talk about that. But the fact is that it's gonna be a patient-specific cost you would present, and it's not integrated. It's just presented next
along
to the
benefit. With,
exactly.
Okay. All right, very, very helpful. Dan Ollendorf, although you haven't ventured into oncology yet, ICER has come up with an approach that uses things like, in part, cost per quality, just a life year, I believe, and you also, in a rather innovative way that others really haven't done in this context, is trying to have some reflection of impact on overall healthcare costs.
Right.
So can you tell us, and I know it's tough to do briefly, can you kind of give us how your approach is working, Dan?
Yeah.
And again, I just want to emphasize, many folks are listening. Dan?
So, okay, no pressure. Good. So a little bit of background, a tiny bit of background. So the value framework that we've developed, we decided that because we try to operate in all aspects as a multi-stakeholder organization, we wanted to get anyone who has a stake in this game at the table. So we developed our framework in conjunction with a development group of which ASCO was a member. We had patient advocates there as well, employer representation, industry representation, and payer representation. And so while none of those individuals should, we're told they shouldn't feel that they had to endorse our approach, they all had input into our approach. And so what we ended up developing was really a two-pronged system. So as Cliff mentioned, there is what we call a care value component and a health system value component. Care value component considers the cost effectiveness, but importantly, the starting point is really something very similar to what Dana and Bob were talking about. We look at the net health benefit. So we consider the potential benefits and potential harms of any new treatment. If that balance doesn't really suggest an incremental benefit, then most of the cost considerations are really immaterial, right? So if this is really not changing the game in any way, then the cost becomes kind of a secondary consideration. But oftentimes, something's approved by the FDA, there is at least an incremental benefit to be considered, and then the question becomes, what value should we ascribe to that incremental benefit provided? So then the considerations move down the care value chain from clinical benefit to notions of cost effectiveness. We do an analysis for every project that looks at the lifetime cost effectiveness of these new interventions using established metrics, cost per quality adjusted life year gained, cost per life year gained, sometimes cost per adverse event avoided, mm-hmm. other measures. But that really is still not where we stop for care value, because you could consider lots of situations, and many of them in oncology, where there are contextual issues that need to be considered beyond just cost effectiveness. So let's say a new oncologic has a cost effectiveness ratio of 250,000 per quality gain, which is higher than most commonly used thresholds for cost effectiveness, which in the US range between 50,000 and 150,000 per quality gain. But that new product targets a cancer subtype that has no good available treatments for it. That's a contextual consideration that would weigh heavily in someone's decision, and that could be someone who's making a decision at the health system level. Also, there may be other additional benefits and or disadvantages to consider as well. On the additional benefits side, there may be a novel mechanism of action for a new oncology drug that avoids a toxicity pathway that's a major challenge with existing alternatives. So that's a consideration as well. So all of that is packaged together into what we call care value. And that is really to try to
what
inform
you call what?
Care value.
Care value, okay.
Which is what we consider the most important thing to inform the patient and physician conversation. But twinned with that is the notion of, and again, this reflects something that Dana said around the ASCO framework, the notion of being able to make this treatment available to as many people who need it as possible. And that is the affordability question. So in any given health system, at the current price, is this product affordable and available to a potential target population? So the second part of it is the health system value. And I can talk about some of the examples that we've gone through.
It briefly reflects what, though? Impact on?
It's impact on the health system's budget. Okay. So this occurs over a shorter time horizon because health system's budget, not over a lifetime, but over shorter time horizons. So we use a 5-year window. And we consider not only the cost of the drug, but any cost savings that are coming from the use of the drug. So if it's preventing hospitalization, if it's speeding return to work for some patients, other considerations are brought into that budget impact equation, but it's over a shorter time horizon to reflect the reality of how health systems operate.
So that's very helpful. Each of you has described some aspect of flexibility, present the information, people can make their decisions and so forth. The kind of flexibility that you're offering, Dan, is that it seems that even though something may have a high cost per quality ratio, 200,000 per quality is kind of high. As you said, 50 to 100,000 is maybe acceptable. But if it's the only drug out there for something that's killing people, you'll lower the threshold, make it easier, and you kind of get something from novelty as well. If it's the only kind of thing that the only mechanism of action that has ever been shown to work, for example, so there's some flexibility built into that. This notion of cost per quality, just a life here, has been, I will say, anathema in the United States until recently. You're doing it. The ACCHA is also having that. And so something again happened this year that is causing people to say we need to take a stronger look at this. What's also notable in all three cases that you heard is that it's not just what's the price of the drug, right? It's some notion of trade-offs, health and economic trade-offs, and affordability, which is not the same as price. Okay, so Alan, here are these three models. Oh, he's pointing to Terry first. Okay, Terry Langbaum. He's deferring to Terry because we saw
Terry's perspective.
Because Terry didn't mince any words last time, right? Is that okay? So Terry, as someone who is, as you've described, a patient, but also somebody has sometimes budgetary responsibilities and whatnot, how are you reacting to these kinds of value frameworks that are now emerging?
Well, I basically react to them with relief.
Relief.
Because it's the first time that we have something concrete to look at, so that a physician can sit down with a patient and have the conversation about what the patient values and what the evidence shows us. And I think that they are wonderful tools, but that's what they are. They're tools.
Tools.
So one of the conundrums could be that these tools, I mean, it's pretty obvious. When you lay out all the breast cancer regimens and you look visually at the evidence blocks, the ones that look like they're most efficacious at the lowest cost jump out. Okay. So is the next step for those that pay for care and are pretty sophisticated about it are going to make decisions to say, okay, it's pretty obvious which ones are the most efficacious, and unless there is a clinical reason for choosing something else, you ought to be using those. I'm okay with that.
Okay.
Because I am panicky about the cost of healthcare in this country. And cancer care is one of those major costs. It's probably 15 to 20% of the healthcare spend in this country. And the way we're getting good at molecular testing, that cost is going to rise exponentially. And I'm very worried about the sustainability of it.
Uh-huh.
So to have tools like this for people to use to make decisions based on the evidence is a relief to me.
Okay. This is, as you point out, a relief to you. You like the idea of it. You like the idea of having tools.
As a patient, it allows me to have an intelligent conversation about the options. As an administrator, it allows me to think there's hope that we can somehow rein in the care to something of quality, and that that can be discussed with a patient so that their choices can be honored, and it can be used as a tool to do both.
Okay. This aligns perfectly with a question that was just handed to me that says, well, as a patient, how do you feel about doctors presenting you with a tool, whether ASCO or NCCN, to help you understand your treatment options? Do you think it is realistic to understand personal financial impact based on tools like this?
You're asking me?
Try it, Terry.
Okay. So, as I said before, the personal financial impact is so variable, patient by patient, insurance by insurance, that I don't think it gets you there. But it does get you to the conversation about, is the cost important to you? For whatever reason, because you want to leave money to your kids or because you can't afford to pay your out-of-pocket portion. Is that important? If that's important, it helps me as a physician guide you to the most efficacious treatment, taking into account your concerns about cost.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's good.
Uh-huh.
I don't think I would feel very good if I knew that that physician had a personal financial incentive for choosing a lower cost regimen.
Right.
So we need some kind of transparency there.
Yes.
You reacted to that. I mean, can you assure us that that's not part of the equation?
So I resonate with everything you've just said, and I really think that it's a concern we need to put wide out in the open. There should be full transparency around all of these issues. I know this isn't a pathways meeting, but I can't help it too, Alan. You brought it up. I'm going to just second that. It's a great example where pathways are kind of what we're talking about in a lot of ways, about taking standardization and creating normative ways to look at the aggregate, but allow for personalization. And I think that one fear people have about clinical pathways is that it's the black box effect. Is the physician getting a bump up in pay because they've recommended this? That's not ethical if that's not something that can be transparent. You know what? There's a lot, though, that goes on, and Shelley and I have had this conversation, and an educated consumer really needs to have a full swath of information to be able to know exactly the pressure points in the healthcare system that are causing. There are incentives all over the place and disincentives. It would be silly for any of us to sit here and say there aren't. We need to fix the system so it's a healthful system, so that we can actually make the rewards commensurate with good care.
Okay.
And I think that everything you've just said in terms of the way we want to look at these tools, they're just the start of a conversation. They are not intended to be used in a static sense, and we need to be very careful for unintended consequences.
And some of those unintended consequences may be a factor of the set of financial incentives in which these decisions are made. The point was well taken, I think.
And it's not just about the frameworks, it's in general, I think.
Certainly more broadly, yes. Shelley, then back to Alan. Shelley.
So I think if we're going to talk about transparency and incentives, you have to look at the whole system. You can't just focus on one and say we need to be transparent about this one,
right,
when there are already a lot of negative incentives in the system for how we prescribe care that incentivize volume over quality. So, I mean, if we have to be transparent about all of it, not just picking one out.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, the idea of these tools as a starting point for the discussion is important. Because they can't be the sole basis. but it just concerns me. I feel like they might be more valuable to physicians in being able to look at different treatments and think about what they might, how they might frame the discussion with patients than they would be to patients, because we've talked about so many variables that are not reflected in any of these calculations in terms of my, how is this going to work for me? How does it reflect my values? How does it reflect, you know, the toxicities that are important to me? It's not, that's not reflected in there, even when you, you answered my question about going through looking at toxicities. But that, there are different toxicities that matter more to different patients. So I think we need to be able to look at these from a policy level, from a societal level. But when you talk about using these to help individual patients make decisions, I'm not sure it's valuable, but I would love to see it being tested. And I don't know that either of these have been yet, or I know you guys have talked about it, but I just think that's so important to actually test it with real patients. I know you've talked with us as patient advocates, representatives of patients, and with some patients, but to actually test it in a clinical setting to see how it helps them with the decision making. We developed a tool that we're testing with one of your researchers at Johns Hopkins that helps patients articulate what their values are for care, and then did that help with the discussion about their care? It doesn't bring in cost. It doesn't bring in efficacy. It's just about me as a patient saying what's important to me in my care and being able to bring that to the table, and then did that help the discussion and the decision-making process? So I just want to see that tested. Maybe it's more helpful than I think, but I worry that net health benefit or any of these numbers are not going to help me as a patient because they're based on, they're not based on all of the data that is relevant to me.
So this is a point that cannot be missed, which is test it, evaluate it, refine it, right, Shelley? I mean, basically get it out there in the field. On this point, Bob, of the evaluation part?
So we will be doing that. So one of the things that's really interesting, getting back to Shelley's point about how can patients interpret this information, if you look at one of our multiple myeloma guidelines that has evidence blocks with systemic therapies and the preferred regimens, all of the evidence blocks are exactly identical. Hmm. But that's the point. Because when you then talk to the myeloma doctors, they say all the evidence blocks are absolutely the same, but this regimen has this toxicity, and this regimen has this toxicity, and this regimen has this toxicity. Their efficacy, the data supporting it, and the overall toxicity is the same, but it gets exactly to your point, is it focuses the argument in terms of, so this regimen has this toxicity, and this one. You know, do you have a preference or a bigger fear of one toxicity versus another? So let me also respond to another comment that we have received a lot of feedback on, and I'm surprised it hasn't come up in the questions yet.
Bob, if you saw the stack of questions, it's in there somewhere.
Well, maybe I'll take care of half of them then. Yeah. So one of the concerns we've heard is that the payers are going to look at these evidence blocks, and they are going to deny payment because NCCN or ASCO has given a high cost to it. Believe me, the payers know what they're paying for these regimens already. Yeah. They don't need NCCN to tell them that this regimen is extraordinarily expensive and this regimen is really very inexpensive. They know that. What the evidence blocks do and the ASCO tool and presumably ultimately the ICER tool does is it makes transparent to everybody what the issues are. Mm-hmm. So this is really empowering patients and physicians by giving them additional information. It's not a threat that the payers are going to say, oh my God, I didn't know that trastuzumab was an expensive drug and now maybe I shouldn't pay for it. They know that. They know that with a lot of precision. So I don't think that these are going to be used to withhold therapy from patients.
Actually, we did have a question or two about the payers. Alan, Dan, back to Dana.
Okay.
Well, I might respond to that point, then I have a sort of bigger point to make. But I think, since we've had this conversation, I do agree, yes, the payers obviously know what they're paying, but I do think it's a bit more dynamic than that. I do think, because the payers, you know, I make a distinction between coverage and cost, right? So what something costs to society, what something costs coming off the manufacturing shelf, so to speak, is different than what a patient pays, which gets to what's affordable to a patient. And that a lot of different factors weigh into that. So it may be covered. It may be cheap to you.
and the whole care experience may be cheap to you if it's in network and it's covered and it's in formulary and it, you know, it's not on a specialty tier. That same patient with the same disease, same product, it could be a completely opposite affordability experience because it may be out of network, it may be off formulary, it may be on specialty tier. You may have to travel farther to get to that care. I mean, there's all sorts of things that play into that. And ultimately, a lot of what determines that affordability from a coverage perspective is the payers. So you could see a payer taking something that that maybe for some cases is low value or low efficacy and making it less affordable and therefore driving up the affordability and taking it off the formulary, not because of the affordability piece, because that's often, they control that. It's sort of it's a fait accompli then. You've showed that it doesn't necessarily have, from a clinical perspective, maybe doesn't have the efficacy of the safety profile relative to some other product. But now I'm looking at that, well, let's make that less affordable. There's no reason to make that affordable. You can also take that affordability rating and, sometimes you need coverage, right? So a lot of this is political theater. So you may want to not allow coverage to something, but the advocates in the world and the patients who have been benefiting from that may want that and will raise trouble for you in the political arena and in the media environment if you eliminate it. So in some cases, you may be giving them cover to do things that they wouldn't ordinarily do for PR or other reasons. So just keep that in mind. But going back to the question you asked me just about all these tools, and I think you make an important point, they are tools. I think a tool in isolation is not going to be as effective as a system that you need to support a tool. So, and this sounds like a little pie in the sky, but I think it's achievable. What I think you need is a system around shared decision making that has five elements. The first is you need a system. You actually need a platform, a known process and system for shared decision making. That's one. You need to have the patients trained and they know how to execute and engage in that process, and the providers need to be trained and know how to execute and engage in that platform. It needs to be reimbursed, so it has to be paid for, and it has to be measured. The success and the quality of that shared decision experience has to be measured based on the patient experience. So what I would offer is, I think it is important to have that tool. So you need to have a tool to help drive that decision making. But I think what that tool needs to reflect, and I know there's a lot of limitations to be able to do this, but I don't know that they're as great as we might think they are. But what I would say is, let's come together as patients and as providers and sit down and figure out how to create that system. And I think when you create that system, that form will then drive the function of what the tool does. And so does the tool provide, I like where you're going with the dynamic scoring, because I think that's ultimately what you need, because I think part of the trouble with these is the patient sees a score, and it's a priori. These are set scores, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, or 92, or whatever. I don't know that that is information that is as relevant to the patient as, all right, and it may spark a discussion around, what's important to you, but I think that's where it should start. And then that then reflects, all right, so based on what you've told me that's important to you about safety or benefit or cost, here are different options that match up better. Here's the scoring for different options that align with what you've just described to me. So getting more to what you're trying to do, I think, is the point. But I think even if you had that capability, that tool in the absence of that system platform that I talked about is not going to be as effective. And ultimately, it has to be tested and, row tested to make sure that it's going to achieve, not only pre-tested, but post-tested.
So it's a start, not only conversation starter, but it actually helps elicit patient preferences in that it says, well, how important is efficacy to you? What about the toxicity? And ultimately, is affordability an issue for you? So it may even pull out information that way as well.
Yeah.
Dan Ollendorf, thank you for your patience.
These comments are great. And I think there is no other clinical area than this one in which there is so much individuality to consider. What I always go back to when I hear discussions like this is that let's try to get evidence on this. If there is a subgroup of patients who are more likely to respond and they can be identified at treatment initiation, then that's great. Let's have evidence on this. All of these value frameworks, ours, NCCN's, ASCO's, are intended to be used in as many subgroups as people want. It's not just one overall cookbook that can be applied. And if there are patient preferences for avoiding certain toxicities over others, industry, you all have focus groups when you're developing drugs. You hear from patients about what's important to them. Try to tailor development around that. So I think that the better the evidence in these individualized situations, the better able we are to take these frameworks and then apply them.
Dan, two questions actually ask about the ability of these frameworks to reflect what you can learn from precision medicine and genomics. In other words, do we have enough data on subpopulations as well as molecular information that may qualify the frameworks? Are you to that point where you can actually take that into account?
Well, again, I think that any diagnostic that's either a companion diagnostic or a standalone that can be used with a set of drugs mm-hmm. has to be tested and evaluated using the same evidence standards as the drugs themselves.
Okay.
So if they actually positively affect use of appropriate treatment in a subset of patients, then that's a validation of the test's effectiveness.
And you'll use that evidence to the extent that it's available?
Sure.
Okay. Dana, thank you.
I think you were in my head because everything just started coming out that I was thinking as well, and that's nice. A few points I just want to reiterate. One is, to Shelley's point, any tool alone is not going to get us there. These have to be starting points for a systematic change and improvement in how we do business, really, as a society. And I think that my one concern I have is that I think there's a lot of fear about unintended consequences of tools that can inadvertently shut down the development of tools unless we're careful to understand the context within which they're being created. And what I mean is they alone need to be looked at as an incubator for change. And if we don't see them that way and we see them as the fait accompli, we're going to all be in trouble. Nobody would feel comfortable with that. And so I think that's an important consideration. I think one of the things we heard a lot about this morning and this notion of personalized medicine, and cancer is the epitome of personalized medicine to be and today, it could be that personalized medicine can make care more affordable over time because we can get the right care to the right person, and that if the data are such that we can populate frameworks so that we see exactly of the four different regimens for non-small cell lung cancer, for example, a person has a biomarker that shows they're going to respond, it's a no-brainer. So one of the things that is woefully inaccurate, I think, today, and I think many would agree, is that our current clinical trials enterprise is not really quite doing what I think we can do over time to collect data in a way that we can more quickly identify truly the personalized nature of medicine that's needed. And then I get to, and this is another topic, but mm-hmm. really relevant is the notion of big data and the ability to harness that data to more quickly inform and learn about all the populations that are never represented in those clinical trials. And we talked before about how the average patient, you know, we don't know how we're going to be affected if we take a certain regimen just because the New England Journal of Medicine said it was going to be that way for that aggregate population.
True enough.
And we need to fix that.
Speaking of things that may need to be fixed, with regard to all of you have talked about some economic component, costs, what have you, affordability. A couple of the questioners ask about the ability to embrace the full range of cost in oncology, for example. So much attention is focused on expensive therapies, but there's so much that happens before, during, after, in survivorship and so forth. There's a whole kind of stream of costs over time. Dan, you started to refer to kind of longitudinal cost capture. Are you able to consider that in the oncology area, by the way, since I'm going to ask you about that in a moment? Are you thinking about trying to capture all those costs, or are you forced to just look at costs for which you've got kind of publicly listed prices, for example?
I think we endeavor in all of our analyses to look at the full picture of costs. So the notion of lifetime cost effectiveness tries to address the situation where, I think it was Alan that described this, treatment situation in oncology is such that you have a lot of upfront costs. A lot of the benefits are realized downstream as patients survive for longer periods of time. Mm-hmm. Lifetime cost effectiveness approach is intended to try to capture all of those effects.
Okay.
And if there are, as I mentioned, there are savings in the health system that are yielded by the use of a therapy, reductions in hospitalization, emergency room visits, what have you, those should be captured as well.
A few questions have come in about who's going to use these things for what purpose. And Bob, you nicely addressed the issue of Are payers simply going to say, well, I will pay for the least costly one, the most affordable one, and you point out, well, heck, they already know the prices of these things. When you consider the various target audiences for your frameworks, pharma bio industry, physicians, other clinicians, patients, the public, and payers, do you see them working at cross purposes, or toward the point made earlier, is there some sort of unified or aligned movement across the stakeholders that benefits all? In other words, these tools might be used to separate views and be contentious, but it can actually focus us on something that's better. Dana?
So I'll take a stab. I'd love to hear others' perspectives. I sure hope, and I really do believe, that the more we can take a look at different models that could work for certain stakeholder populations like the patients and make it work for the 360 of stakeholders involved in the ecosystem of healthcare, we're going to win. You know, we're not going to win if we create a solution that is anathema to another major stakeholder in this community. And I mean in the medical healthcare enterprise of society now. So we're not there, I know that. But I think what would be really, and I will tell you, ASCO's tried to, even just by creating a tool for the doctors to use with patients, we went from the very beginning, stage one, to take our task force that had primarily oncologists, but it also has patient advocacy representation, as well as in manufacturing and payer. And we actually made sure to hold stakeholder, this is just as an example, stakeholder feedback meetings early in the iteration of this process, not because each of those were going to be end users of the tools, but because we wanted to learn and understand ultimately how these kind of tools would impact each of those stakeholder groups. Because ideally, the right kind of tool is going to work best for the patient, be least problematic for the others, and actually allow the entire system to thrive. That's a tall order. I really do believe we can do that, but we've got to be talking together to do it.
Yeah. Terry, can you align with that as well?
It made me think about the discussion this morning about navigation and how it's so valuable when it's done right by the right people at the right point in time. And it's not valuable at all when it's done in other scenarios. If we could bring the insurance companies to the table, I don't think anyone's here from an insurance company, are there? Are there a few?
Couple.
Bring the insurance companies to the table. They spend a huge amount of money every year on care management.
They do.
And if they could take that care management money and put it where it really would make a difference to patients, there's a net same cost to everybody, but the outcome is so much better. And I think that's exactly what you're talking about, is how do we disrupt this very broken system and change it in ways that benefit the patients, truly benefit the patients, by educating and empowering and helping them make decisions that fit with what their choices are, rather than legislating the choices for them. And I think that we have a lot of the tools, not all of them. We could develop tools if everybody was sitting at the table, and we don't sit at the table together. It's adversarial.
Not often. Quickly on that, Dan, yeah.
Yeah, so it is safe to say that a lot of the products of our reports and meetings are used by payers to help determine coverage policy. We've had innumerable conversations in recent months with payers, though, about the fact that that does not need to be a traditional conversation where the payer's trying to whack the manufacturer with a stick and say, I want the price to come down to X. It can be more of a partnership. And in fact, on the heels of our PCSK9 meeting, there were two arrangements that have gotten some press that are essentially a partnership between the manufacturer and the payer around essentially pay for performance contracting. So the notion that there is some discounting that occurs, but if the therapy doesn't meet the targeted goal, in this case it's LDL lowering, then there's an additional discount that the payer receives.
Wow. Right.
So those kinds of partnerships, and in fact if a payer sees that a manufacturer is trying to discount pricing to come close to some of the value thresholds that we've set, that others have set, or guideposts, I should say, for discussion, maybe it's a carrot, not a stick. You know, first tier, lower minimal copay, so that there can be a reward for essentially trying to come to the table and and bargain as equals?
Well, the transparency helps. The insistence on quality, quantity of evidence helps, and stakeholder participation certainly helps. Alan, on this point?
Yeah, so I was going to say, I think what is concerning from the patient advocacy perspective is somewhat what you described, that these things, whether it's your, some of these tools are going to be used to drive coverage decisions, and that means restricted access for patients. So I think that's what keeps us up at night is, you know, and that's not necessarily a bad thing if the framework's inherently incorporated the things that really matter to patients. And I know they include some very important things, you know, to society and to clinical, to certain clinical factors, but I would argue that they don't yet, and we don't have the data yet to really capture all the things that are important from the patient perspective. So I think that's, I think the idea is a good one to create these tools, but I think that goes back to my earlier point. We need to sit down and stop and think and come together and say, all right, what data do we truly need to be able to collect to be able to understand what are the benefits to make this truly patient-centric? And that's what it comes back to, is are we measuring things and are we basing these things on data and information that we know reflect value, benefits, and costs to patients, right? And that's where we're going to, if we do that and we create that tool and that system, that's where we're going to end up winning and creating that system that creates better value overall for the patients. Yeah. So that's, I think, the conversation we need to have is where are the data gaps? How can we get those data? There's a lot of opportunities that patient advocacy organizations can provide data that can help inform these things around what's value to patients. So, I think they're the right idea. I just don't know that we've come together to kind of figure out how to create the system to really make this work in a way that's patient-centric.
But there is the inclination to do so.
Yeah.
I don't see any opposition to that. Shelley, briefly?
Well, I think there's the inclination to do so. I'm glad to hear that some of this research is helping bring payers and industry together, because I feel like that there's so much, patients get caught in the crossfire. I'm still just a little skeptical, though. You know, I think that we have to look at cost to society. That's very important. But a patient should not be thinking about and will not be thinking about cost to society when they're making their decision. So, right. There, some do, but I think that's probably the minority. When you're deciding about your treatment, right, about, you know, how to save your life, that's not your concern. And rightly so. So I'm not sure that there's going to be a tool that will accomplish both. Mm-hmm. Even if it's the most patient-centered tool in its design, I think there's a place for looking at cost to society, but it's not the patient's responsibility.
You know, for what it's worth, I mean, all these offer that they're providing a basis for decision-making, that they're not executive per se. Just wondering if you kind of take the notion of presenting the information, comparative information, and taking account of some economic component that may be helpful to patients and inform patient navigators, mm-hmm, who know their way around these systems and frameworks and can speak on an individual basis with patients about their issues with affordability, for example, their issues with their costs, or their deductibles and co-insurance and so forth, and get more personalized about it with these as supportive tools, there may be a way to get there. Hope so. Question in the back. And I thank you very much for your patience. Name and affiliation, please.
Yeah, hi, I'm Randy Hillard, and I'm a stomach cancer patient, and I'm going to be your case study right now.
Today's a synopsis of the case study.
Excuse me, I'm going to do it really quickly.
Okay.
Today's my fifth cancerversary, though. But quick case synopsis, December 2010, stage 4 metastatic stomach cancer, HER2 positive. And 1 month before I was diagnosed, Herceptin was approved, trastuzumab, for metastatic stomach cancer. I'm still getting infusions every 3 weeks. I'm pretty sure my original prognosis was far less than a year. Every 3 weeks, I'm getting an infusion that costs $17,000, including the NCCN Comprehensive Cancer Center's charge, plus the medication. So if you multiply that out, my quality is costing $289,000 a year, which clearly is way too high. And so I feel pretty good, actually, about the NCCN and the ASCO approach to this, but I'm really worried about the ICER approach. And the other aspect is that whereas there is some good data about breast cancer that's HER2 positive having chronic treatment, there isn't for stomach cancer. And so I'm kind of worried about evidence-based medicine, since few people other than the ones in the clinical trials have been getting this any longer than I have. And so in a way, you know, evidence-based medicine, when you get down to the personal basis, and also the fact that, you know, as my oncologist always says, not particularly reassuringly, we're kind of in uncharted territory here.
Indeed.
And so how do you, like, value, like, care in terms of uncharted territory? So that's me.
Just before you put down the mic, you referred to $289,000. Was that $289,000 per quality-adjusted life year?
Every 3 weeks, I get an infusion that costs $17,000. So 52 divided by 3 is 17, and 17 squared is 289.
So they say.
Why should we believe them?
So, Dan, I know you may not necessarily get into a particular case, but some treatments do rack up high cost per quality adjusted life. I think you suggested originally that there is no hard and fast threshold, but can you shed any more light on these sorts of instances?
I think in this particular situation, this is where some of those contextual considerations would come into play. So whether or not there is actual hard evidence on the benefits of Herceptin in this population, if there is some inkling of evidence that there is benefit and there are no good alternatives available for patients in your clinical situation, I think a lot of decision makers would take that context very much to heart. So the cost per quality thresholds are there. They're used as an input into the overall care value consideration, but not the only one.
Okay, very briefly on this, and we're going to move on. Yes,
very quickly, just to put a plug in, because the other alternative is also, and it shouldn't it be an alternative, it should be the option in these kind of cases, is to remember clinical trials. And we have 1% of cancer patients on clinical trials. We're not going to get there if we don't get more people in those trials so we can learn what's happening over time. So
absolutely,
that's crucial.
And as discussed this morning, patient navigators may be helpful to do just that, indeed. Ever so briefly, Dan, people do want to know, what's ICER going to do in oncology? What do you have? What do you?
So we've got a review scheduled for July 2016, looking at the recently approved and nearing approval drugs for non-small cell lung cancer.
Okay. So.
So it's a class review.
The timeline would look like what, briefly?
So we've announced the topic generally. The process will start in January, in which we'll. We will post a scope for the review, which has a public comment period associated with it. About 2 months before the meeting, we'll post an initial draft report, which also has a public comment period, and then we'll revise that report based on input we get and other considerations. And then the public meeting itself, which is open to anyone, will be in July, sometime in July 2016, and I believe it's the New England program, so somewhere in New England.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes.
So if you're reviewing and scoring drugs that are recently approved or about to be approved, how do you incorporate in a robust way the long-term benefit of that product in your initial review?
Because it's so new?
Because it's so new. So based on clinical trial data isn't designed to really determine the long-term benefits of a product. It's, we know what those are designed to achieve. So curious how you score something. You quite eloquently and accurately said you have to incorporate that long-term benefit horizon to be really able to do a cost-effectiveness ratio and calculate some sort of net present value. That's sort of cost-effectiveness 101.
Yeah.
So how do you, in that context, score something that hasn't been out in the post-market world so you don't have the opportunity to collect that real-world data that tells you more about, and even though, and probably I would argue we don't necessarily have the best ways to capture those data that really speak to some of the intangible benefits of those products.
But how do you do that? He made the point. How do you do it? You don't know enough.
In the audience who've done economic evaluation and cost effectiveness analysis in particular will know that there is a fair amount of speculation involved because you're dealing oftentimes with shorter term clinical trials. You're trying to extrapolate those effects over a lifetime. You try to test things using sensitivity analysis to try to understand how robust your estimates are. But it's also the case, and I'll be honest and say we haven't cracked that nut yet, but we're going to need to update these reviews as new evidence becomes available. So the PCSK9s were based on surrogate endpoints, those initial trials that resulted in approval. There are cardiovascular outcome studies, but they're not going to be available for 2 more years. We're going to have to look at those data and say, do we need to modify something based on this?
But in the meantime, your analysis may limit coverage and access to those, so you won't have the ability to look at it down the road because people aren't going to have access to it or be using it potentially. So.
Understood, but I think that what we're trying to do is to enable discussion that will hopefully bring the price, the acquisition cost of these drugs, closer to the potential value that could be perceived by patients.
Yeah.
And if that price comes closer to the value, I think our argument is that those restrictions on access should diminish.
So
that really should be what happens.
Transparency, stakeholder engagement, quantity and quality of data, and the ability and the willingness to update and revise, right? It's not, you're never quite done. Okay, we're going to go to 105 in case somebody needs a time check here if our panelists cooperate here. So closing question is actually very close to a question that was posed by one of the folks of our attendees, and that is basically, well, what's next? So we heard about three frameworks here, and what since we have three framework people and three patient sort of people, I'm going to ask the framework people sort of from a technical standpoint, what's the next kind of version, whatever, 2.0 or 3.0, whatever it is, what attribute is it going to have? Not a long answer, short answer. What attribute is it going to have that's different? And then from our patient people, what do you want to make sure is incorporated into any next iteration? And we'll start with Alan. We'll start with the patient side. And just one or two things, max, sure, you want to make sure that you see in these frameworks.
Yeah, and I'm not going to reiterate, in length, I would say the systems, thinking about a system for shared decision making, as I described earlier, but also making sure that as these, and then the tools can be designed to match that system, but then I think the tools need to have the ability to be dynamically scored to reflect the value that the patient ascribes to different safety, efficacy, affordability profiles. So then the score that's generated, I think, along the lines of what you were trying to get to, and I know we're not there yet, but I think, so it's a start, but I think that's really going to be where this makes sense and has a better context to the individual patient. When I see what the score is based on my personal values of benefit, this treatment scores of this based on what I've said is important to me.
Yep, dynamic scoring, individualized. Thank you. Bob, what's going to be in the next iteration?
I think there are two or three foci. One is that we need to extend this exercise beyond systemic therapies to diagnostics, surgery, radiation oncology, all the larger components that actually are most of the healthcare costs in the U.S. I think we need to develop systems and tools, if you will, on how to use the tools. We need to educate providers and, as Alan pointed out, I think it was patients in terms of actually how to use these tools. And then third, as I think Shelley pointed out, we need some demonstration projects. We need some focused sort of real world experience in the fishbowl to actually see how these tools are used and whether they have utility in the clinical shared decision making process.
Okay, so the next iteration is going to have at least three or four new components. Thanks very much, Bob. Well, Terry, what do these things need to reflect next time around?
I think that I would vote for them being directional more than having a score. I worry about scores because I think people will take them more seriously than they should be taken, because until it incorporates all of the personal characteristics of that patient, it doesn't have value. So I think making sure that they lead us to a discussion and a direction and a plan for a patient has tremendous value. And there's nothing good about fee-for-service healthcare. Nothing. The incentives are completely wrong. But if this can lead us into directions that will allow us to get to other methods of compensation for healthcare, I think that's very positive.
So you're sounding upbeat then?
Yep.
Okay, although in a different payment system.
Yep.
All right, well, thank you very much. Shelley? What do they need to have next time?
So I know you don't allow ditto as an answer, but I do agree with what's been said. I think that being able to score, if you are, I like the idea of directional better than scoring anyway, but if you're going to have scores, that they need to reflect individuals' circumstances and preferences, including, you know, like Bob said, looking beyond just the systemic therapies and looking at the entire cost of their care and their impact on their family and their life. My aunt was just diagnosed with breast cancer and is going in for her consult tomorrow. And for her, the biggest consideration is that she continue to work because she has to, and not because she, I mean, unfortunately, I wish she would be able to take off, but she can't. So that is her number one concern. Yeah, and that's not really reflected in any of these tools.
Okay, well, another element worth considering. Thank you very much. Dan, next iteration?
Perfect segue. So we are looking into ways that we can more explicitly consider indirect costs, including benefits for productivity, reductions in caregiver burden, other kinds of costs that really are not always easily obtainable. Sometimes they're studied in clinical trials, most often not. But we know that that's in a very important consideration, particularly in this area. So that's one feature that we're looking into very explicitly. The other, which also has some effects in cancer as well as other kind of known terminal conditions, in some cases, neurodegenerative diseases, for example, there's not only a notion, but there's a body of research that supports this notion that the value of any additional quality-adjusted time on Earth is different in oncology and these other conditions than it is in other chronic diseases. And so we want to try to take that into consideration, particularly with this upcoming review.
So you are going to pull that one in for this iteration. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Thanks very much, Dan. And Dana, finally, what's it going to look like next go-round? What attribute?
So keep that up, because if that happens, which I'm confident it will, we'll all have the data to make all of these tools much, much more informed and complete. And to me, that's the biggest need we have today. We need more data. We need more data on many, many more parameters of what it means to have a good care experience, what it means to have a good outcome, what it means to be of value to the patient, and what it means to call something high value to society. I think that for ASCO, we know that we actually do use the 2.0 language. We're working on it. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned, we're taking the public feedback that we got and we're putting that in. We're going to make changes to our framework most likely. Some will be coming out now with its next iteration that will be used to actually try out a clinical interface, or rather a technical interface, so that we'll have a built way to actually use the tool in the clinic. That's our next step.
Oh, good.
When we do that, we're going to need to test it. And that testing is going to not only inform the actual tool, it's going to hopefully, and I believe it will, allow us to understand what are all of the ancillary tools that need to be part of the tool, right? It's not going to be in a vacuum. It's got to be with good decision-making science behind it. It's got to be with good scripting to understand. It's got to be to understand the relationships of all the provider team and where they integrate and who does what part of the framework discussions. These all are things that we still don't understand well in terms of medical decision-making and cost and value considerations. Finally, just again about the data. The more we can understand and put into clinical trials the kind of endpoints that everybody here has talked about needing, patient-reported outcomes, the longer-term issues that affect people in terms of late and long-term effects, we need better capture of that in a more uniform way. It's another perfect way that manufacturers should be partnering here, and I know we've talked to them. They're interested in actually creating better ways to measure these things at the point of the trials so that we can have that information
Great.
To populate what
Great.
We have.
Thanks.
Yep.
Rather ambitious, if I might add, in terms of version 2.0, but we'll be watching for those.
Okay.
So we're going to break for a moment for lunch. I'm going to tell you now that lunch is next door. I'm going to tell you now that we're going to reconvene at 2:03 to pick a number. I know we've taken a few more minutes of your time. Listen, I told you at the outset that this was a hot issue. If questions from an audience are any surrogate for interest in a hot issue, this is the thickest stack we've ever had for questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get to all these. But listen, please do join me in thanking this great panel of Alan Balch, Bob Carlson, Terry Langbaum, Shelley, Fuld, Nasso, Dan Ollendorf, and Gary Wollins. Superb. We're going to have to do it again just to get to some of these questions. This is a great issue. Thank you all.